Very good. Welcome to Mayfield First United Methodist Church. We are an exuberant bunch today, an enthusiastic group. That's always a good thing. Enthusiasm means literally to be filled with God. So I am excited to hear that you are so excited to be here. There are many things happening in the life of the church. I'd like for you to take a moment just to pull out your bulletin, take a look at all the things that are happening. There is one correction that I'd like to make. The youth and children pool party that's listed in the center, that's today, not next Sunday. It's correct on the back, but it is today, the youth and children pool party. So if you're attending that, make sure you show up today and not next week. It will be awkward if you come next week. As for the rest of the announcements, circle the ones that pertain to you. Make sure you make a note of those in your calendar. Underline the ones that you're not going to be attending. Pray for each of them. They are important things in the life of the church as we reach out to the community and bond with one another. Today I want to let you know how great the kingdom is. We're going to talk about what the kingdom is and what that means for us to be kingdom living people. How to follow after Jesus Christ, who is our King. And how we sometimes get that mixed up in our minds. But today we're going to focus in especially on the act of worship, giving God all the glory and honor that God deserves. That's why you came. That's why I came. We're going to lead you in that. But your job, your task, the work of the people, liturgos, the liturgy of the church, is to do exactly that, to worship the one true God. Did you bring your very best today? Okay, those of you who did, show everybody else how it's done. We're going to worship God. Let's do this. Beside you, however you want to do that, that's fine. I'm going to ask that the adults, if you'll put a hand on a shoulder, just make sure you're offering blessing. And where you are in your seats, if you'll offer blessing where you are, in whatever way you see fit, as we give thanks to God for these beautiful, bright, shining faces. Look at y'all. I can just tell how happy you are to be going back to school. Look at this. Oh my goodness, bright, smiling faces. Some of you don't know how happy you are yet, but you will. Let us pray. God, we give thanks for the beauty of education, for learning, for the understanding that there are things that we don't understand. And we ask, oh God, that you would open hearts and minds that we might receive knowledge, that we might know wisdom. As always, God, we ask that your Holy Spirit would lead, guide, and direct us in the learning that is required of us, that we might be the best disciples that we can possibly be. We give thanks to you in the name of Jesus Christ for teachers, for students, for the schools, for the administrators, for everyone who has a hand in the care, the love, and the education of our best, our brightest, our greatest treasure, our children. We lift all of this to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Go forth and learn, children. Learn much and be well. And remember, church, this is not a one-time blessing. You bless children every time you say a positive word about their lives, a positive word about what they're doing in school. So you get to continue to be the blessing. We're keeping that theme of keeping the church at work. You've come with difficulty in your heart, on your mind. There's someone in your life, it may be you, dealing with a rough patch, an issue that's greater than they can handle. It might be medical, it might be financial, it might be interpersonal, relational. It may have to do with family, it may have to do with work. It may have to do with something that's going on right there in the house. Whatever it is, we lift those things up before God. Petitions and intercessions are simple. If it's about you, you make your petition to God. You ask for God's assistance. If you're interceding on someone else's behalf, by definition, that's an intercession. I would ask that you would take a moment to remember and to be silent and to pray. And then, when I raise my hand, would you call out names? Just first names. We don't need to know the whole story because it's not for us. This is for God. Let us center ourselves and remember. Almighty God, we are careful to lift before you the names of your children. We are filled with care and concern. Replace that concern with peace. Replace all of the stress and worry and anxiety with your compassion so that we might be found in your service among the people who need it most. The names we have lifted, the concerns that we have kept quiet, because it's not time yet to say them aloud for reasons of confidentiality or privacy. We ask, O God, that you would empower us to be vessels for you. Help us to pour ourselves out, to empty ourselves of the things that we want, that we might be filled with the things that you want for us. Send us in the direction we should go, O God. Receive our praise this day. Hear our thanksgiving. And know that we live in a world that is filled with broken and hurting people. And sometimes we are that broken and hurting person, craving your healing. We are mindful of your love, O God. And we understand that whatever separates us from you has very little to do with anything in this world that has any kind of power. So we ask that you would help us to set ourselves aside, that last obstacle might be overcome. We praise you and we welcome the kingdom's coming. All in the name of Christ, who gathered disciples to himself and taught them how to pray with these words, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have given God our praise in song. We have given God our intercessions and our petitions. Now let us return to God some of the thing that God has given to us. Some of our treasure, some of our giftedness. It doesn't have to be money, folks. It can be a little bit more of your time. It can be a portion of your day. It can be part of your strength, your resolve, your resources. If you have a tithe covenant with another congregation, it's my responsibility to remind you that they'll be expecting that when you come home. Make sure you take that with you. If you have a tithe agreement here, this is the time to exercise it. And if you don't have any kind of tithe covenant anywhere, and you just want to give a gift that honors Jesus Christ, we promise to use that gift in a way that will bring the kingdom as close to as many people as possible. Let us pray. And now, God, we are grateful for the gifts that we have been given, and we return a portion of those gifts to you. Receive them, O God, and make our hearts light and glad. All in the name of Christ. Amen. Pastor. We also give thanks and praise for Community Fellowship Baptist Church and Brad Henson, her pastor. We do not labor alone, either in the task of worship or in our mission and ministry to the world. We are a part of a vast network of Christian believers, and we celebrate that this morning. Let's do a little reading from the New Testament. This is a tough reading, y'all, but I need your help. We're going to practice what we do at home here now by reading this passage together. Are you ready? From there, Jesus took a trip to Tyre and Sidon. They had hardly arrived when a Canaanite woman came down from the hills and pleaded, "Mercy, Master, Son of David, my daughter is cruelly afflicted by an evil spirit." Jesus ignored her. The disciples came and complained, "Now she's bothering us. Would you please take care of her? She's driving us crazy." Jesus refused, telling them, "I've got my hands full dealing with the lost sheep of Israel." Then the woman came back to Jesus, went to her knees and begged, "Master, help me." He said, "It's not right to take bread out of children's mouths and throw it to dogs." She was quick. "You're right, Master, but beggar dogs do get scraps from the master's table." Jesus gave in. "Oh, woman, your faith is something else. What you want is what you get." Right then, her daughter became well. This is the word of God for you who are the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. And now, God, we ask that your teaching ministry might occur, that your Holy Spirit might move among us to change our hearts, to change our lives. And we will be very careful to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory that results from the coming near of your kingdom. In the name of the Christ we pray. Amen. How many of you used to play as children and dress up as a king or a queen? Anybody? Did you ever break a flower pot, do that thing like in The Wizard of Oz or The Cowardly Lion? Crack that thing open, stick it on your head. I don't see anybody raising hands, but I hear some chuckles. You either know about it or you're just not telling. Well, I'll tell. We used to talk about being kings and queens, especially when we got to school and started reading the classics about Narnia. And we saw how children could go through a wardrobe and enter into a magical land where they were made to be kings and queens. Fantastic story. So, of course, we had to get in on some of that. We had to have our own chance to be kings and queens. And as luck would have it, there just weren't enough thrones. You know what I'm saying? We had some yard chairs that we would turn into thrones out behind one of my buddy's house, and there just weren't enough thrones. So we would say, well, it's my turn to be the king. No, it's my turn to be the king. And before long, there was a battle that broke out. As happens when kingdoms go to war, we set up our rival territories, and we would have yard chairs in one yard, and we would go to somebody else's house, maybe across the neighborhood, and have better yard chairs. Look at what good kings and queens we are. And then we would raid one another, because we figured that's what kings did when they attacked with armies. We didn't have all the different aspects of military that we wanted, so we had to do most of the dirty work ourselves. It usually involved taking a chair that nobody was looking, watching over, and claiming that throne as our own, running that back over to somebody else's house and setting up our kingdom again, now with the added bonus of extra throne. That worked great until the people whose chairs we were taking came out and said, "You kids, get off of my lawn and stop taking my yard chairs." No, it didn't happen that way, but somehow it seems that kings and kingdoms ultimately end up being about power. It ends up being about who's got what, who deserves what, and what we're willing to do to keep those folks from getting what we've got. Jesus demonstrates this today in a very difficult passage. If you spend too much time dwelling on this passage, the thought will come to your mind that Jesus was holding back compassion, that Jesus was holding back love and care for a woman because of her ancestry, because of her nationality. Did you notice that? It's something that we spend a lot of time on in seminary. We bang our heads against walls like that. But I tell you, it comes out to a very happy place. It comes out to a place where Jesus, as he's making his point, as he always does, he does so with compassion and love. He rewards her for her persistence. Your faith is something else. I like that translation from the Message. Not all of the things that you hear in the Message are worthy of our study, but I like the way that that's translated a lot. Your faith is something else. How many times have we passed by someone who has a need so great that they're willing to beg, that they're willing to sacrifice their human dignity, to ask for what they need, because they come to that point with tears in their eyes, with nothing left to lose? How many times have we passed them by simply because we were already on a different side of the street before they ever got around to kneeling and begging? You see, the kingdom that we serve, the kingdom of which we are a part, is not about the power that we have that is ours to give away. It's not about the glory and honor that we get because we're disciples of the one true King. It's not about crowns and thrones. I want you to see that crown and those keys. The keys in our tradition represent the keys that were given to St. Peter, the keys to hell and heaven, the gates that were unlocked as a result, the freedom that was offered because Jesus established a ministry for people to have a way to come. come out of that bondage and live in freedom. And here's this Syrophoenician woman, this Canaanite, this person who's not like Jesus. They didn't worship the same way. They didn't live the same way. Their language was slightly different. Their understanding of their place in the world was definitely different. If you do some strict translation here, Jesus even insulted her with the use of the term dog. What was he trying to say? I think that Jesus was pointing out that the least, the very least, the last, the very last in society, even though we have been taught to say, no, get away, this is for our children. No, get away, this is for our community. No, stay back, you don't get to have any of this because you're not the right kind, color, creed. I think that Jesus was embodying those principles to show folks what happens when faith overwhelms even that kind of disparaging comment, even that kind of meanness. Think back to a time when you were unintentionally cruel, when you withheld something from someone thinking, well, I don't have enough, I need all of these, and I can't give this to my friend, only to find out later, perhaps, that they went hungry that day. Something along those lines. Or a time when you kept for yourself something that maybe should have been shared with another person. Those moments don't bring us joy. Those moments don't make us think of ourselves in a positive way. Those moments are not our best moments. And yet they happen again and again. We find that those are sometimes more frequent than they ought to be. We sometimes find that they are the norm in our society. We see neighbors who accomplish this by withholding what they have from neighbors who don't have enough. We hear about ministries that are running low on supplies, and many of us run to help. But why would it run low to begin with? Why aren't we thinking about these things intentionally? Well, we are. Mission and ministry is something that is at the heart of what it means to be a part of Mayfield First United Methodist Church. I have been ecstatic to find that that kind of mindset is not only a part of what we do, it's at the heart of what we do. Because folks, that's what it means to be a part of the kingdom. There's no jockeying for position. There's no fighting over who gets to sit in what throne. There's no arguments about whose scepter is bigger or better. There's no battle over the crown. Because the crown belongs to one king, King Jesus. I'm very fond of saying it this way. If there were a little window that allowed you to look into the depths of your heart, you'd find a tiny little throne. Now, those of you who have any kind of medical understanding realize that this has become a metaphor. There's no throne inside your heart. But if there were, if that tiny little throne were visible, if you were able to see who's seated on the throne of your life, if it's not Jesus, it's time for a revolution. It's time for whoever is sitting on that throne to be overthrown. Because it's not really about a battle for power. It's about a struggle for powerlessness. It's about allowing the world to have whatever the world wants. Because what we need is Jesus. The woman who came to Christ and asked, begged for what she received, knew that nothing else mattered. Her dignity was gone. Her resources didn't matter. She might as well have had nothing, and probably did. She had come to that point where she realized that there was nothing for what her problem was except for Jesus. And not just the divine and miraculous Jesus, but the everyday Jesus, the Jesus who teaches us to live in community, to open our table to those who are not like us, to share in the love of community with people who are outside of the community. You want to talk about how great the kingdom is? Talk about how great the kingdom is in terms of inclusivity. and the fact that we span the globe. The fact that we have reached out to people who are not like us again and again and again. You've been to revivals where pastors talked about the least and the last and the lost and encouraged those folks to come to Jesus Christ. Not because they look like us, not because they act like us, but sometimes precisely because they don't. Who are the Canaanite women in your life? Who are the people who are being shunned? As you go through your daily life, as you walk up and down the streets of Mayfield, as you go about your business and your place of work, who are the folks who are on the outside? Who are the people who are not being included? Who are the folks who are just different enough that, oh, we don't invite them to lunch when we go because, you know, they wouldn't fit in. Who are those people? Because I would say to you that your King and mine has given us the example of including them despite those differences. Even though they may have been insulted by us, even though they may have been excluded by us, our King says no more. And because of the faith of this Canaanite woman, he relents and he offers healing. And it's a moment of transition. Do you see? Throughout the remainder of the New Testament, we see how the grace of God now transcends the boundaries and borders of Israel. We see now that culture and nationality has nothing to do with how much God loves the world. Easy, easy Bible quiz. Complete this sentence. For God so loved the world. Now, somewhere in that verse, people like to try to find the word except or the phrase but not. This is not true. It is not there. You may look for yourselves. It's John 3:16. The exceptions that are made to that particular verse happen because we are human. Because we are still broken. Because we are still children running from house to house, stealing yard chairs from our colleagues and compatriots in an effort to maintain our own power base. And that childishness is what makes the world a harsh and difficult place for those who are without power. But then Jesus changes all of that. And Jesus teaches us what real power looks like. It's abandoning that need, that hunger, that pursuit of power. And it is only when the Syrophoenician woman comes to her knees, begs for Jesus' help, and turns her life over to him, whatever may come. That powerlessness afforded her the power that she craved, but not in the way of the world. Not as a result of armies and navies clashing with one another. Not as a result of world leaders posturing and posing and bumping chests. It has everything to do with focusing on the one true King. Back in the Old Testament, the children of Israel looked around and said, "No, everybody else has got a king. We don't have a king. I think we need a king." Did they actually need a king? No, thank you. Just making sure. They got one anyway. Why? Because they were persistent. They asked and they asked again. And they got Saul. And how did that work out? Not so good. Then they got David. A little bit better. Chief among sinners, if you ask some theologians, Bible scholars. David had some difficulties. He was still the apple of God's eye. Even though you might be the best leader ever, no matter what your skill set is, no matter how powerful you are in terms of your ability to speak before large crowds, to motivate people to certain issues, to motivate people to certain actions, none of us will ever be Jesus Christ. And the primary reason for that is because we don't live in the mode of Jesus Christ as leader. We live in the mode of grabbing power, holding power, keeping power, preventing others from taking our power. And when we live in that way, we're making ourselves exceptions to the kingdom. Because the kingdom is about receiving those who are powerless. It's about those who would stop being selfish, becoming selfless, to receive the powerless. Are you listening, church? Who are the people that Jesus is calling you to, even now, to demonstrate through you how great this kingdom is, how wonderful our Master Jesus Christ is, and how fruitless and futile the ways of the world are in light of the one who sits upon the throne of those who would claim Jesus to be their king? How great the kingdom. It's not about crowns. It's not really about keys. It's not about the flowing robes. It's not about scepters, thrones, gems, jewels, treasuries, armies, navies. Nothing like that. It's about giving of ourselves until everyone is included in the kingdom. It's not a physical place. It's not a political definition. It's not dots and lines on a map. It has everything to do with the understanding that we talked about briefly last week. Where is the kingdom of heaven? Where is this kingdom of Jesus Christ? It is at hand. That's not a temporal thing. It's within reach. That's geography. That means that wherever you go as a follower of Jesus Christ, the kingdom is there. So long as you embody what it means to be a citizen of the kingdom. Selflessness, giving yourself away, compassion, kindness. I'll give you a better list, and you'll only need 9 fingers. Does anybody know where this is going? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You only need 9. That assessment will allow you to see how clear the definition is of the kingdom where you are. It's not about winning. It's not about losing. It's about loving. Because that's what makes our kingdom, God's kingdom, so great. Let us pray. God, we thank you for your love, for your compassion, for your example through Jesus Christ, for the kingship that he embodied and indeed even now embodies. Teach us what it means to follow a king who gives himself away. Teach us what it means to give ourselves away. Let our lives be poured out, O God, and filled back up for you, that we might be found in the shadow of the Canaanite woman on our knees, begging for the attention and graces of King Jesus. We ask this in the name of Christ and for his sake. Amen. If you're ready to give your life over to a different kind of king, a different kind of leader, a different kind of authority, I want you to come down and say so today. If you're ready to give your life to Jesus Christ, that's what we'll do. If you've done that before, but you realized you were doing so in a strange sort of way to try and gain some power and some personality and some standing in the community, and now you're ready to give that away, that you might follow Jesus even more closely, would you come? If you're part of another congregation, but God is calling you here, not because we're about stealing lawn chairs or anything like that, but because you found your place here, and not just in a seat, but within community, I want you to come forward. And finally, if you don't know what in the world you're supposed to do, and you simply need some time at the chancel rail, come down and pray as we sing our last song for the day and move into mission and ministry from this place to that world, taking the kingdom with us. Come as you're called.
Through eternally we send praise and praise. Glory in the highest.
told you I'd give you some time back because I ran over on Wednesday night for those of you who were here. We have 10 full minutes left. Here's what I want you to do with them. We're going to do the benediction. But those of you who are going to use them for kingdom-building purposes, to reach out to your neighbor and love one another, y'all get to go first. Reach out, grab hands with your neighbor. The words of the benediction will be on the screen. They are yours to say to one another, to carry with you in your heart, and to use as a model and template for how you invite people to come to church. May the peace of the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Go serve your neighbor, and those of you who are starting now, go first.